James chapter 1, let's stand for the reading of the word, James 1, verse 5. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally, and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. And I'd like to preach this morning on unstable souls. Father, we are glad this morning for the privilege that we have to worship God in spirit and in truth. Lord, I thank you for this Lord's Day that you've given us, Resurrection Day, the day that we come together and celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior. Father, I pray that you'd help us to give you the glory that's due to your name. I pray for the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Pray that you'd make up the difference between what I am and what's needed now for this service, God. I pray, Lord, that you'd help us, that we'd not leave like we came, that you'd do a work in our hearts, and we'll give you the glory for it. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. You may be seated. In my text, James warns his readers of the instability that's caused by a double mind. The double-minded man is that man who is pulled in two different directions. His thinking is influenced by the Word of God on the one hand and by the counsel of the ungodly on the other. This state of mind, the double mind, causes him emotional and mental tension. His heart is divided. And he may be convinced that he must live with this condition. And many people are convinced that they must live with this condition throughout life. And as long as he thinks this tension to be the normal Christian existence, he'll seek no relief from it. But the tension in this life of the double-minded person will continue until he surrenders either to the authority of the Word of God or to the appeal of the world. And he will eventually surrender to one or the other. If the double-minded man rejects the Word of God, gives himself to the thinking of the world, then he will likely experience great relief for a season because he's no longer struggling with a divided heart. He may even testify to his family and to his friends about how wonderful it is to be free from the bondage that he's been under, the bondage of the Christian community. He no longer feels any obligation to be faithful to the worship of that Christian community. He no longer feels any obligation to conform to the morals and traditions of that Christian community or to involve himself in the mission of the church. So he has solved his indecision by rejecting the ways and the will of God and declaring his independence from any moral and spiritual authority outside himself. He feels like he's gotten rid of a great burden by becoming the master of his own life. And if Satan can keep him happy in that condition, in that state of rebellion, he'll lead him into the fires of hell with a smile on his face. But once he gets there, he will never smile again. I want to present three aspects of the double mind. First of all, the content of that double mind. Secondly, the crisis that's caused by that double mind. And thirdly, the cure for the double mind. First of all, the content of the double mind. The double-minded man lives with two opposing thought processes. Romans 8, 6 and 7 tells us about those clashing mental states. For to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, and neither indeed can be. The carnal mind is fueled by earthly wisdom, and the spiritual mind is fueled by the wisdom that is from above. I want you to notice in James chapter 3 and verse 14, the contrast between that earthly wisdom and that wisdom that is from above. This earthly wisdom is what governs that carnal mind. And this wisdom that's from above is what governs that spiritual mind. Notice James 3 and 14. If you have bitter envying and strife in your heart, glory not, and lie not against the truth. This wisdom descendeth not from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. For where envying and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work. But the wisdom that is from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, easy to be entreated, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality and without hypocrisy. Look at the fruit of the carnal mind. The mind that's governed by fleshly wisdom, bitter envying, strife, confusion, every evil work. The church at Corinth was troubled by people influenced by the carnal mind. In 1 Corinthians 3, verses 1 through 3, Paul rebukes those troubling the assembly of the saints. And I, brethren, could not speak unto you as unto spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as unto babes in Christ. And Paul acknowledges here that babes in Christ exhibit remnants of carnality. I have fed you with milk and not with meat, for hitherto ye were not able to bear it, neither yet now are ye able, for ye are yet carnal. For whereas there is among you envying and strife and divisions, are ye not carnal and walk as men? Paul obviously expected better from them than this chronic condition of carnality. He reproved them because when they should have been spiritual, they were still exhibiting aspects of carnality. Now look at the spiritual mind, the fruit of the spiritual mind, that is governed by the wisdom that is from above. The Bible tells us in James 3 and 17, this is the fruit: purity, peaceableness, gentleness, easily entreated. That is, it listens and responds to reason. Merciful, impartial, and free from insincerity or hypocrisy. What a contrast between the two modes of thought, the carnal mind and the spiritual mind. Now, secondly, that's the content of the double mind. Secondly, I want to deal with the crisis that's caused by that double mind. I want you to see that this double mind errs in its estimation of God. It fails to trust God. It doesn't get answers to prayer. because it errs in its estimation of God. Notice in my text, in verse 5, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. The double-minded man errs in his estimation of God. And really, what happens in this double-minded man is he ascribes to God the same mental condition that's struggling within him. So he ascribes to God moral and mental tension or instability. And he projects his own image on God. And that's why that James writes to try to correct that estimation of God. And he says down here in James 1 and 13, let no man say when he's tempted, I am tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, and neither tempted he any man. Skip down to verse 16. Do not err, my beloved brethren. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights. Listen to this. With whom is no variableness and neither shadow of turning. God is not double-minded. God is not unstable. God does not vary. I'm telling you, brother, that the double-minded man projects onto God the same problem he's got. But God's not unstable, and God does not vary. Hallelujah. He is not double-minded. And the Bible assures us of that in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, where Paul is talking to the Corinthians, and he says to them in verse 18 of 2 Corinthians 1, but as God is true, our word towards you was not yea and nay. For the Son of God, Jesus Christ, who was preached among you by us, even by me and Silvanus and Timotheus, was not yea and nay, but in him was yea. For all the promises of God in him are yea, and in him amen, unto the glory of God by us. In other words, God does not vacillate. It's not yea and nay. It's yea. It's definite. The promises of God are true. You can count on them. You can depend on them. You can build on them. And the double-minded man fails to believe God because he considers God to be like himself, unstable. But God is not unstable. You can trust God. You can have faith in God. This is the crisis caused by the double mind. But it not only errs in its estimation of God, but it is easily led astray. The double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. In 2 Peter chapter 2, Peter describes the moral looseness of false teachers. But in spite of the fact of their obvious deviation from the Word of God, and he describes that deviation in 2 Peter chapter 2, these people are able to deceive unstable people. Paul says in verse 14, Peter says, having eyes full of adultery, describing these false teachers now, having eyes full of adultery, and that cannot cease from sin, beguiling unstable souls. In spite of their moral perversity, they are able to beguile unstable souls. The double-minded man is unstable in all of his ways. He's susceptible to being led astray. One reason why that double-minded man is so susceptible to deception is because he has a tendency to discount any scripture that condemns his lifestyle. In 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 16, Peter states that the epistles of Paul contain some things that are hard to understand. And he declares that they that are unlearned and unstable unstable rest or twist or distort the Scriptures, as they do also the other Scriptures, unto their own destruction. In other words, the double-minded man is inclined to self-deception and to deception by unscrupulous religious teachers. This is the danger, the crisis of the double mind. Thirdly, there is the cure for the double mind. The cure for the double mind, listen to me now, the cure for the double mind, this multiple personality, is not on the couch of the psychiatrist, but it's on the altar before God. This is where the cure is found. In James chapter 4, verses 8 through 10, James exhorts us, draw nigh unto God, and God will draw nigh unto you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Be afflicted, and mourn, and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning, your joy to heaviness. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and He shall lift you up. And I'm telling you that there is a cure on the altar before God. He will purify your hearts and solve your double mind. Praise God. Now, I'm going to issue a warning to you this morning. You will not continue to live with this tormenting tension in your mind and heart. Eventually, everybody is going to seek relief, either on the altar of surrender to God or denying God your whole heart. And I feel like that there are people in this church who are seeking to balance two conflicting and irreconcilable worlds. Listen to me. Some people are standing with one foot in the light and one foot in the darkness. And soon, maybe today, you're going to turn one way or the other. One foot in the darkness, one foot in the light. But you're not going to stay there. You're torn. You're living a tension between the carnal mind and the spiritual mind. And if you turn and go into the darkness, you're not likely to ever get back to the light. And you will influence people to follow your example, and generations will perish with you in that darkness. If you turn and go into the light, renouncing the darkness and everything that that darkness represents, you will live. For the Bible says to be spiritually minded is life and peace. The Bible tells us, now listen, in my text it tells us, if you lack wisdom, if you have been influenced by the wisdom of this world, ask God for wisdom, and He will give it to you. It shall be given Him. Wisdom from above that's pure and peaceable and easy to be entreated. This kind of wisdom that comes from above, that governs the spiritual mind. If you ask for it, you can have it this morning. God will give you that wisdom that's from above. He will sanctify your heart and sanctify your mind. He will purge you of that carnal influence and make your personality unified in pleasing God. I'm telling you, brother, it's important to have a single mind. It's important to have a single eye. It's important to get rid of what's dragging you away from God. I read this story of a brother and sister. They were making a trade with each other. The boy had some marbles, and the girl had some candy. And so the boy wanted the candy, the girl wanted the marbles. The boy agreed to swap his marbles for his sister's candy. However, he had some prize marbles he didn't want to part with, so he decided to hide them from his sister. The exchange was made. Sister gave him her candy. He gave her his marbles, except for those he had concealed. That night, he couldn't sleep. Sister slept soundly. He can't sleep. The reason he can't sleep is he keeps wondering, did she give me all the candy? Now, the reason why that you fail to trust God is because you haven't given to God everything in your heart. And so you're like the little boy that can't sleep. He can't trust his sister because of what's in his own heart. And I'm telling you, brother, when you give everything to God, when you sell out to Jesus, when Jesus is your all in all, when you surrender that carnal mind, when you let God cleanse you of that carnal mind, and you have the mind of Christ, and your life is guided by the wisdom that's from above, you don't have to live with this tension all of your life. You can sell out and have the joy of the Lord and walk in the light as He's in the light and enjoy the fellowship of God. Hallelujah. You don't have to be drawn to the world every day of your life. You don't have to be in bondage to this double mind every day of your life. You can get rid of that double mind. God will sanctify your mind and heart this morning, and you can walk in the liberty granted by the blood of Jesus Christ today. Praise God. I want Sister Judy to come to the piano this morning. I'm telling you that there is victory over the double mind. You're not going to live with that double mind forever. You're going to make a choice. You're going to make a decision. You're going either to the darkness or the light. You're going to make a decision somehow to get rid of this tension in your life. And the way to get rid of it in the right way is to come to the altar and give God everything. My wife's great-grandmother had this saying, if Jesus is worth anything, He's worth everything. And if He's not worth everything, He's not worth anything. And she proved that by her life. When God saved her soul, her husband was dead, and she was growing tobacco to make a living. And when God saved her, she sent her boys out to the tobacco barns to dismantle the tobacco barns. And they said, Mama, you know, what are you thinking? This is how we make a living. She said, I know. But she said, I'm burning my bridges behind me. I'm giving everything to Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. When she died, she called her preacher boy to her bedside. Brother Dewey Yates, he was the conference superintendent of the Western North Carolina Conference of the Pentecostal Holiness Church for years. She called him to her bedside and she said, son, she handed him 50 cents. She said, this is all I got left. She says, when I gave my life to Jesus, it cost me everything. But she said, if Jesus is worth anything, He's worth everything. And if He's not worth everything, He's not worth anything. And I want to tell you, Jesus is worth everything. Hallelujah. Oh, glory to God. I tell you what I'd like to see. I'd like to see some souls around this altar selling out to Jesus this morning. Wholehearted. Get rid of that tension in your mind. That split personality. The psychiatrist can't cure you, but the blood of Jesus can. You don't have to be fighting in your mind and heart with the wisdom of the world on one hand, the wisdom of God on the other. I'm telling you, you can be purged from that carnal mind and live a life of victory with the mind of Christ guiding and directing your life. I want us to stand together this morning. Altars are open. Oh, this is what we need. This is what we need. Create in me a clean heart, Lord. Is there anybody in this place that you feel your need of getting rid of this tension, this split personality, this being drawn in two directions at once? There's somebody in this service that you've withheld something from God. It's time to lay it all on the altar and set out to Jesus and say, Jesus, you're worth everything. You're worth everything, Jesus. Some are coming. Are there others that will come? Let's seek the face of God this morning. Let's get victory in our hearts and souls. Let's not live with this tension in our lives. And renew a right spirit within me.